Hey, it's Kay, and this is Skittles, Animal Behavioral Specialist. Amnesia Rebirth came out recently, and it was alright. I kinda wanted to make a video about it, but to be honest, I felt myself spending a lot of my time with Rebirth thinking about another game. A game that was critically panned when it came out in no small part because so many things its predecessor was adored for were completely absent from it. But I've been thinking about it ever since I first played the Chinese Room's Amnesia, A Machine for Pigs.
I live. I breathe again. I rise. I will rise to bleach the sky and still the water. I will spin the world wheel and set the future upon the path to redemption.
Where are my children? You promised me my children.
My time is come. More pig. More pig!
This game really pissed people off back in 2013. The walking simulator was a fairly new phenomenon at that point, and gamers did not like it.
I like a good story. And apparently the Chinese Room does as well. The difference is, however, is that I like video games also.
Amnesia, A Machine for Pigs is a disgrace to the original Amnesia.
What the hell happened to having an enjoyable, fun experience like one normally does in games? No inventory!
Amnesia, A Machine for Pigs not only proves that the Chinese Room can't make a powerful horror game, but that they also still struggle with the concept of game versus interactive storybook.
This game shouldn't be exist!
It was not well received. I think people have become a little more open-minded about the boundaries of what a video game can be since 2013. But there is still certainly a contingent of people who get offended if a game doesn't have what they consider to be video game things, such as combat, puzzles, item management. But I, for one, am glad A Machine for Pigs doesn't force you to spend time on loads of puzzles or search around for items. And the few times it does have you hiding from monsters in a way akin to the first Amnesia, it's honestly one of the worst parts of the game. A Machine for Pigs is not about surviving, or stealth, or fighting monsters. It is not an adventure. It is a descent, a relentless downward trudge into an unfeeling machine that serves no purpose other than destroying human life. And every step you take deeper into its bowels, things only get worse. It's a familiar feeling. You play as Mandis, a wealthy industrialist in Victorian London just before the turn of the century. While mucking about in some Aztec ruins, Mandis did what Victorian Englishmen with too much money are wont to do and went snooping around where he has no business being, disturbing an artifact that gave him visions of the century to come. What he saw terrified him. He saw every atrocity of the 20th century. He saw both world wars. The Holocaust, the bombs dropped on Japan, death squads, coups, ethnic cleansing, all of it. And he saw his own sons die in the Battle of the Somme. Mandis could not bear the things he'd seen and began to build a machine to stop it by sacrificing his own children, an act that he imagined would spare them the horrors of the First World War. Mandis gave the machine life. Giving a part of himself to the machine and granting it sentience. And so he began his plan to prevent the horrors he had seen by making sure there were no humans left to commit them. He would turn every human on Earth into a pig. At first, it's tempting to compare Mandus and his machine to a character like Thanos, from those Batman movies the kids like. Thanos' whole plan was to wipe out half of all life in the universe as an answer to resource scarcity, believing that if he did not do so, then these civilizations would collapse, killing even more people in the long run. The ideological underpinning of Thanos' plan is based in Malthusianism, which posits that there will be a point where population growth will outstrip our ability to produce food and will lead to mass starvation and the collapse of society as we know it. This idea has led to a troubling number of people responding to global poverty with some variation of, there's just too many people. It's worth being explicit here that the number of people is not the cause of poverty. An economic system that unevenly distributes resources is. YouTuber Renegade Cut put it best in his excellent video on the topic.
Thanos is wrong. There is enough food, more than enough, in fact. We just don't allocate it properly under our current economic system. There is enough space, more than enough, in fact. There is enough energy. We just don't utilize renewable energy sources because they are not as profitable as non-renewable energy sources under our current economic system. The problem is capitalism.
I wanted to explain all of that because it's noteworthy that Mandus's plan is specifically not Malthusian. He is not killing some people to make life better for the rest of them. Before even getting into the baggage of who the some people might be, he is not concerned about running out of resources. His plan is to kill everyone, so that there is nobody to carry out the atrocities he has foreseen. His position is that our future is too violent, too unbearably tragic and miserable, to the extent that non-existence is preferable. Mandus has no intention of making anything better. It's interesting how Mandus basically externalized all of these fears about the future into a whole other consciousness that exists within the machine. Not unlike the way many people today, looking at the seemingly hopeless state of the world, externalize those fairly justified anxieties and form them into a character of their own, the Doomer. The beliefs of the Doomer are that the systemic oppression, environmental destruction, and total economic destitution of billions that define this stage of capitalist development are unfixable. Basically, that we're fucked and should just give up and wait to perish. Much like Mandus's machine is a part of him, the Doomer is, while presented as a meme, as a character, it is very much a part of the person who is expressing these ideas and identifying with this meme. Some people fully believe in this position of hopeless defeatism, while some use it as more of an ironic cover for how unbelievably stressful the world is, but it still rings true for them to some extent. And I'm not unsympathetic to this position. Doomers, you're not imagining it. The world is a hideously unjust place. Billions go hungry while the richest people on the planet become even richer. Even in the middle of a pandemic that has killed over 1 million people, in fact, I think 1.5 million at time of recording, in no small part because those same rich bastards have been keeping the pressure on to keep us coming into work and making them their money and getting sick in the process. On top of all of that, we're increasingly destroying our environment and setting ourselves on a track that leads towards making a lot of this planet completely unlivable. And even the so-called progressive options we're permitted to vote for are offering to do jack shit about it. And we're bombarded from every direction by a sophisticated media apparatus that demands our attention, our clicks. So it feeds us footage and stories about this misery and death. And it's nonstop because, as if to ensure that all of us are as ground down as humanly possible, we developed the technology to project all of it into our homes at every hour of the day. We are in dark fucking times. If you could look into the future and see what will happen throughout the rest of the 21st century, who knows what you'd find. But that worldview feels a little incomplete. Let's return for just a second to the critical reception A Machine for Pigs received. I don't want to suggest that the people who felt this way about the game were somehow naturally closed-minded. There are narratives pushed by the biggest companies in this industry that choice and player agency are everything. They are the ultimate expression of whether a game is good or not.
Be who you want, exploring a huge world.
But at the very core is choice. Is that you as players get to choose how you play, what you play, when you play, and what devices you play on.
Where the choices are yours. Where you'll decide what happens. You'll decide the heroes, and you'll decide the villains.
Player agency is extremely important when designing a game, but what can get lost in the marketing of these big, open-world AAA games that promise hundreds of hours of exploration and 1,000 different ways to build your character is that when and how you restrict player agency is just as important. Every game does it to some extent, but the walking simulator was startling to some people because of how much it restricted it. In games like Gone Home or the Chinese Room's previous game, Dear Esther, you couldn't freely explore an open world and play the game however you wanted. You were there to experience a specific narrative, a specific way. And I can see how that might be frustrating when we've put so much value on freedom and choices in video games. For some people, it must feel stifling. It must feel like being on a conveyor belt, going through an assembly line and just having things happen to you, with no real input or control of your own. And goddamn, don't you get enough of that at work? Is it so much to ask that in your few free hours between getting home and waking up to go back in to spend another 8 to 12 hours in a place where you have no control and no say in what happens to you, that you can come home and play a game that lets you do what you fucking want? In a lot of ways, Mandis's machine feels like a physical manifestation of the function industrial capitalism fulfills in real life. An embodiment of the very system that keeps us so exhausted, that produces doomers in the first place. It's hard not to think about as you descend deeper into this machine, this thing, so immense you can't even wrap your head around it, that's just constantly moving. The gears always turning, always grinding away at us, leaving us smaller somehow, reduced, just a little less human. You can point to powerful individuals and lay some of the blame at their feet, but upon closer inspection, they only reveal themselves to be another gear, a soulless functionality of the machine. It can feel like no matter how hard you try to fully comprehend the machine, there's always part of it outside of your reach, still just grinding away. Maybe this game should feel like it's suffocating and restricting, like it's taking away your agency and forcing you down a linear path, whether you like it or not. That's what the machine does. And the scariest part is the machine thinks it's helping us. When you've descended so far into the machine, it can be easy to forget that it wasn't always here. But if you try, you can still imagine what outside looks like. You can still catch those little glimpses of light. And if you're a doomer, if that word means something to you, you can too. I know you can. Because I know you give a shit. You've built an entire identity around how much you give a shit. I know people who genuinely don't care. They're not this miserable. They're not spending this much of the day dwelling on how fucked things are. They're living it up in blissful ignorance. You're not, because you give a shit. Mandus gave a shit. You don't build a machine to end humanity because you don't care. You do it because you don't see a way to fix any of this. And you just want the suffering to end.
A child's shadow burnt into the brickwork. A house of skulls in the jungle. The innocent Mandus trod and bled and gassed and starved and beaten and murdered and enslaved. This is your coming century. They will eat the Mandus. They will make pigs of you all. And they will bury their snouts into your ribs. And they will eat your hearts.
We have something Mandus didn't. The ability to look back at the 20th century. Amongst the horror, there was beauty. Workers raised their banners high. Colonial slave states were overthrown. Civil rights were fought for and won. And there's a pattern. All the war, the mass death, the oppression, they didn't come from single bad individuals. As much as we try to fit history into nice little boxes like that, all of that came from the system, the machine, the industrial capitalism that strives to make us all into pigs, that reduces life to an assembly line, moving dispassionately towards profit at any cost. But the victories, the hope, those precious fucking rays of light, they came from the people. The people are not the machine. The people want what you want. They want to be safe, to be fed, to not feel like the world is some horrible monster slowly devouring us all. And by looking at our history, we know that we can fight and win together. Because in those moments, the machine failed. In the end, you destroy the machine. You know full well the horrors that are to come, but you destroy it. You allow the future to be born. To me, standing right alongside all of you on this precipice, where environmental disaster and the looming authoritarianism of capital seem to be grasping up at us from the abyss, there is one sentiment I can see, one statement inscribed into every inch of this game. It's a plea and a command at the same time. Don't let them turn you into a pig.
You're gonna have to say that I am a proletarian. Got to make a decision, and the people are going to have to attack the pigs.